I like trains.
Yes, you do.
Hello and welcome to the final part of our three-part series, Making Tracks, Railroads, and the Irish. Today, decline and disaster, reuse and preservation, and train travelling throughout Europe. We'll be looking back at what's gone before and seeing what's still ahead on today's final episode of Making Tracks, Railroads, and the Irish.
In 1842, from Hartlepool, I moved to Crewe, and I found myself a job to do, working on the railway.
Where are we going first, Dad?
Let's go and find out why the lines were abandoned first, shall we?
Okay. Then can we go talk to Dennis about being there when they pulled the rails up?
Yep.
Do you think he's sad about it?
Well, it was a long time ago, but you know, I think things changed for a lot of people when it happened, and some things were lost forever. So maybe you're right, maybe he is.
I'd be sad.
I would be too. But there was a couple of good reasons they stopped using some of them.
These lines began to be kind of abandoned from late 1920s kind of onwards. Probably the first to go was the Cork Blackrock and Passage Railway line. And basically, it went because the roads got better. The roads became tarmacadamed. People could actually cycle on the roads for the first time. If you look at the pictures of the city and the countryside roads way back 90 years ago, and they're gravel kind of roads. Even the roads in the city were actually gravel. So it was very hard kind of to get around. So once this idea of kind of tarmacadam roads began to be introduced, and we say around kind of 1926, 1927, in fact, the first major tarmacadam road actually in Cork was the Carrigrohane Straight Road. And of course, running alongside the Carrigrohane Straight Road was the Cork Musgrave tram. So now the road became faster than the Cork Musgrave tram. So that was one of the effects. I mean, definitely by 1931, the Cork Blackrock and Passage Railway line actually closed. And I've no doubt there were subscribers in the 1930s that actually suffered. Probably more early 20th century, people began to kind of to lose money and lose maybe faith in the railways as well. Especially, I suppose, as the car was invented and kind of came in the 1910s, the middle and upper class began to kind of invest in cars and in buses and kind of in trucks as kind of time went on. So there was this kind of shift away from railway lines to kind of other modes of transport. It was certainly like the last major expansion of a railway line in Cork was in 1904, where the line was extended from Passage to Crosshaven. Now, Crosshaven at that time was becoming a major tourism hub for Cork people and the south of Ireland. So very much was aimed at the tourist market. And also things like Youghal. Like Youghal was the tourist hub like 100 years ago and was a tourist hub all the way up to 1960s, 1970s. And very much with better roads, bigger trucks, quicker methods of moving your animals around if you were a farmer, and especially if you were a passenger that wanted to get to your destination quicker, the road was a quicker place to go on. Probably the biggest closure was the Cork Bandon and the South Coast Railway line in 1961.
With the shortage of coal, a lot of passenger trains ceased in 1947. And between 1959 and 1962, a lot of the branch lines were closed when Dr. Andrews came as chairman from the Bournemouth turf bogs, including the Harcourt Street line, which was a crying shame that time.
When the decision to close the line was announced in August of 1960, it came naturally enough as a great shock to the people of Cork City, but especially to the people of West Cork. Moreover, because of a recent large investment, many mistakenly thought that their railway would be secure for many years to come. Petitions were signed and protests were lodged, and eventually a deputation headed up by the then Bishop of Cork, Connie Lucy, travelled to Dublin to try and persuade the relevant minister to change his mind, whose name was Todd Andrews, is reported to have asked the deputation after the meeting, "By the way, lads, how did you travel up today?" Their answer was, you've guessed it, by car.
They brought in the Craven coaches and done away with the wooden coaches. Actually, the wooden coaches were on the train in the Butterfin rail crash in 1980, which were made, some of them were made of matchwood. That's how so many, 18 people were killed that time. What happened was the points weren't connected to the signal cabin and they were worked by a crowbar. The points were made into the siding. And when the plate layer knew the train was coming, he tried to put back the points and wasn't able to get it back in time. And there was a ballast train loading, ballast for the track, loading in Butterfin station at the time. And the train just went in into the siding and into the wagons. They were very lucky that there was an ammonia train coming up that they were able to stop it. It would have been a complete disaster altogether. As I said, there was 18 people killed in the crash. Bertie Welsh was the driver, and Timmy McCarthy was the guard. After lunch, I heard that there was a bad crash in Butterfin. So I was sent out there. There was a lot of perishable stuff on the train, which I had to get off and get it in by truck. I took a driver with me. There was ambulances from everywhere. And there was air air helicopters as well brought to the scene to bring the injured into the CUH. What happened in, they bussed the passengers from Cork to Charleville and Charleville back to Cork. They had even used the school buses because in August, bank holiday, and you know a lot of people would be travelling on the long weekend.
Yeah, the Bussofen crash, it was a most unfortunate incident. It was a shock to all of us. Because for myself, we lost a number of colleagues on the train, plus the loss of life of passengers, which is very sad indeed. But it was a wake-up call for the railway industry because a lot of the rules and regulations needed to be updated. And through the likes of the Bussofen crash and unfortunately the Cherryville one, which happened afterwards, it made the railway a safer place today. But it was a sad day. I can remember it very well because one of my colleagues that was tragically killed in it, I spoke to him that morning at 5 a.m. and by 1:30 he was tragically killed in the crash, as were a number of catering staff as well. And of course we mustn't forget all the people that were injured in it as well. Some probably still wish us today, they probably still bear the scars. Well, it was basically down to putting in new points. At the time there was a lot of renewal work going on in Bussofen. It was being used for the loading of ballast for the track, the stone for the track, and it was through the installation of these new points which directly led to the derailment. So the rules and regulations were updated as to putting in new points, the way they were to be set. If they weren't connected to the signal cabin, they had to be locked, and there was procedures put in place to manage that. Then one after that was 3 years after the Cherryville crash, and again there was more updating in the rules and regulations after that. The most significant thing, of course, we were operating an awful lot of timber frame coaching stock, which was dating from the 1950s and 60s, which in the event of an impact, they just disintegrated and caused massive injuries and loss of life. So all these timber frame coaches were withdrawn from service, and we bought the new Mark 3s came in from Britain, which made the trains very safe then. And again, there was an update in the rules and regulations. And thankfully, 1983 was the last time there was a passenger killed on an Irish railway. And we're proud of that. And we hope it'll continue.
The big question that has been kind of coming up the last couple of years is that should we actually reopen these kind of railway lines? Yeah, we should reopen them, but I mean, they're going to need a government supplement, a state subsidy. They're not going to run by themselves. You've seen places up the country near Derry or down by Carrick on Shore. There's an old section of the Waterford and Shore railway line that's actually open to the general public as a tourism. It's something like maybe 100 metres of an old kind of railway line, which you can actually go on and actually and get a sense of how slowly it moves and get a sense of nostalgia. I think it's like a 1,000-metre track or something more than that, just slightly. And we're very, very lucky as well in Cork. If you go to Clonakilty, there's a model railway village in Clonakilty, and they actually go through in detail the story of the Cork Bandon and South Coast railway line. So if people want to find out more about that particular railway line, and they've also created little models of some of the villages and the track and so on as well. In relation to the Cork Blackrock and Passage railway line, it's a fantastic community walk. There's a lot of traffic kind of going into places like Mahon Point. I think it's great to have these kind of public walks and public greens. I think people need to relax as well after kind of a busy day. They're great for families, they're great for joggers. I know there's a few cyclists. And I think the amenity values is absolutely enormous. It's great to have a long walk where you can actually clear your head and actually walk down along it and be rooted in something that's kind of old and kind of historic, something that's been there for a while, something that's kind of... I think people see the past as something kind of soothing and kind of calm. The past doesn't kind of annoy you. As such, you know what the past that kind of has happened. And these railway lines have generally, the collective memory of these railway lines is actually quite a positive thing. Okay, there were explosions on them. People were killed. People worked very, very hard on them. In our time, though, they've become kind of great kind of amenity spaces. And we saw recently, actually, on the Cork Blackrock and Passage railway line, where the city council, the planners, and our roads department were trying to put a bus down this kind of old railway line to kind of create a commuting kind of line into the city. And the locals have said no. Councillors have said no subsequently. These walks, they're also safe and they're accessible. And we've seen that people actually really, really enjoy them. They were blessed in the city as well, like places like the Lock and the Marina Walk and the Mardyke and the Lee Fields. And I think as a city, we're lucky to have such spaces. Runaway train, never going back. Wrong way on a one-way track.
So when are we going on the walk, Dad?
Pretty soon. First, we're going to see Dennis and Arthur. Look,
There's the same viaduct again. Do you think you could throw a ball over that?
I don't think anyone could do that.
Someone did.
Wow.
We'll find out more about that later. Do you think you'd like to go on a holiday on a train?
To where? Like, to Dublin?
Well, what about all over Europe?
Can you do that?
Oh yeah, people often do that while they're in college.
My name is Tracy Kelleher. I'm working in the USAID office in Oliver Plunkett Street in Cork. And I'm here today to talk about Interrail travel. If somebody purchases a pass before they leave Ireland or whichever country they reside in, and it allows them to travel across Europe whenever they want and anytime they like. Basically, you can wake up in Paris and decide your next stop is going to be Barcelona. And on that morning, you head to the train station, hop on the train, and hopefully a few hours later arrive safely in Barcelona. And that's basically the concept of Interrail. It allows you to travel right across Europe at your own pace and whenever suits you. Traditionally, it would be sold to mainly students and people in their early 20s, but there is no upper age limit to an Interrail pass. But I suppose we would find that it's mainly when the students finish college, they buy Interrails and head off on their summer break. But it's not completely just for students. It's open to all age groups. Interrail have recently changed the concept of it, and it's now sold kind of in global passes. So you can buy, for instance, a 5 within 10 day pass, which allows you to travel anywhere on the network. And how that works is your pass is valid for 10 days and you pick 5 days out of that to travel. You also have a 10 within 22, again, the same concept. The pass is valid for 22 days and you travel for any 10 out of that 22 days. Then you have a 15-day continuous pass where it can be used every day, 22-day continuous pass, which can be used every day, and 1 month continuous pass, which can be used every day. And 1 month is the maximum pass that you can purchase, but you can obviously buy more than one pass at a time. Basically, Interrail would have initially, when this was all set up, would have got as many countries on board as possible and created this pass to allow people to travel freely through Europe on that particular network. So it's not every network in every country that's involved in Interrail. It's generally one from each country that's involved. So for instance, you can use it on British Rail, but you wouldn't be able to use it on the Virgin network, just to give you an idea of how that actually works. But it's very easy to get right across Europe. Any country within Europe, you are permitted to travel on the Interrail. It goes as far as Romania, I think would probably be the furthest east. So Poland, Slovakia, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, and down as far as Greece and Turkey. Well, actually, probably Turkey as well, be further east, but that's as far as it goes. You can only buy an Interrail ticket in Ireland if you've been residing here for 6 months. So you can also buy the Interrail pass in France or Spain or Italy or in the UK, wherever it is you're living, but you must be residing there for at least 6 months. You could start your trip in Paris in the month of July. You can enjoy the Tour de France. Head from there to, for instance, to Denmark, where you have the jazz festival taking place. Head down from there, maybe spice it up a little bit. Head to Pamplona for the running of the bulls. From there to Austria for the Salzburg Festival. And finish back in Paris, maybe still in the month of July for Bastille Day. So the opportunities and the experiences, particularly in the summer and in the winter, in fact, are just absolutely endless and gives you, really broadens the mind and just allows you to see and explore places that give you so much joy. And, you know, there's so much fantastic scenery and amazing wildlife if you're heading towards kind of Greece or Italy or France or Spain. Like, I honestly can't recommend Interrail enough, particularly for, you know, students who really maybe just finished college, have the opportunity to get out there, explore Europe and see what's on our doorstep. And it's all so accessible. Because you're traveling on your standard rail networks, it's not like you're getting on an organized tour bus where the majority of people on that bus are maybe in their early 20s. And that type of tour may not suit a person who maybe are into their 30s, 40s, 50s. Because there's no upper age limit, Interrail is ideal because people who are not in their early 20s can still travel on this network and not be confined to traveling with a group of maybe younger people. You can get your pass validated in the quieter months at the station before you take your journey. Now, we would recommend in the summer months, you know, from possibly May to September, pre-booking your trip. So, for instance, you wake up in Paris on the 1st of July and you already know that you need to leave on the 3rd of July to head to Munich, for example. on that very first day, we would recommend booking your train ticket at the train station for 3 days later. That's what we would recommend doing in peak season, because very often you'll find the trains can be quite full, extremely busy in the months of July and August. So you may not always get the train that you choose if you don't book in advance. And that can be done at the train station or by calling ahead if you have the language. The pass that we sell the most of is just your standard second class travel. Obviously, if you are in a position to fund first class travel, there is a first class option available with Interrail as well, which is outlined in all their brochures. The cost of it, you have the adult second class cost and the adult first class, and that would be available to anyone to purchase. There's quite a big price difference between, we'll say, for example, the under 26 option and the first class. But if you had the opportunity to travel first class, then it's certainly a great option. You can book your hostel ahead of time through our website, usa.ie. Again, if you know you're arriving in Paris on the 1st of July, you can have your 3 nights accommodation booked there. And there is a worldwide hostel booking engine on that website available to anybody purchasing an Interrail ticket, or indeed any type of ticket across the world. There's no restriction on when you can buy it. Obviously, it's a little bit more popular, well, a lot more popular in the summer months than it would be in the winter, but we do sell the passes all year round.
It was back in 2006, I got holidays at short notice. So my boss just came to one day and he says, look, I won't be around, I'm going holidays next week. Sorry about this. So listen, I'll see you like in 2 weeks' time. So I'm thinking, okay, two weeks. Might as well just buy a plane ticket and go to London. Sure, look, I'll just go to Europe altogether. So, of course, I had always heard about Interrailing, but I'd never investigated before. So, fair enough, I got myself a 2 week ticket, because you can get in blocks of like, I think, 2 weeks, a month, 3 months, and so on. So it allows me to travel within a certain number of countries. I picked, I think it was 5-6 countries. So I had the ticket for France, Belgium, Netherlands, Germany, and Luxembourg, I believe it was. So that allowed me to travel for those 2 weeks on any train in any part of the country, which was great, great. Like, you just basically hop on, hop off, hop on, hop off. So some of the tickets, some sections, you had to find a ticket office prior to boarding your train. Could have been 12 hours or 24 hours. Now, before you board your train, present your Interrail ticket and say, I plan to travel on this train at this time. Because in some countries, in some sections, I suppose, they're highly organized in the sense that I want each person to have a specific seat. So when you get on the train, your name is there on a digital screen above your seat. Besides that restriction, it was offer great freedom. You can literally go anywhere at any time, as long as there's a train, as long as there's a railroad track. Flew from Dublin to London. And like, I'd never gone traveling on my own before, so half of me was thinking, am I a bit mad? I kept going and got to Waterloo Station. And it's like, for me, who grew up in the country, I was fair enough used to cities by this stage, but Waterloo was kind of a new experience. But it was amazing. I just loved it. Got the train, then went through security, of course, because of the Schengen zone thing, and took the train to Paris. The Channel Tunnel was an interesting experience. When I was leaving London, got on a TGV. So it's extremely, like, it's beautiful. You sit down, you've got your own seat reserved. You disappear underground, and like, it's fully air conditioned, fully lit. So as such, you wouldn't really know the difference between traveling in the tunnel and traveling at night time. For all intents and purposes, it's the same thing. And it's great facilities on the train. You can get everything there. There's a bar there, there's food, there's toilets and everything. So it's really smooth. So you got all kinds of travelers. You got backpackers, you got people going business, people just going for a short holiday. So the great thing about it, I loved altogether, was, I suppose, just meeting the different people and people being willing to chat and people being willing to talk. Because at the end of the day, I suppose there's so many people going on an adventure that they wanted people to share and to talk. So I met every kind of a character, from the kind of characters that I suppose you'd want to avoid to the kind of characters that you'd want to chat to. I remember I did quite a bit of research before. I contacted this youth hostel anyway in Paris, and I says, how many minutes walk are you from the Eiffel Tower? And he says, oh, we're about 10 minutes walk. So I get to Paris anyway, booked into the youth hostel. I says, great, left my bag there. And I says, sit to the man at the desk, which direction is the Eiffel Tower? Because I had decent enough French, and between French and English, I got my directions. So I went to the Eiffel Tower, 10 minutes supposedly. So of course, an hour later, I found the Eiffel Tower. Paris is beautiful, but the whole thing of traveling from A to B to C, I thought was great, because just being able to wake up in the morning with my Lonely Planet and decide, where am I going to go in the world today? The scope of the ticket allowed me to travel a certain distance, a certain radius within Europe. So that was excellent. Yeah, so I suppose the longest I would have stayed in a train was perhaps 3 hours, 3.5 hours between high-speed trains and the local connections. So they were quite comfortable. I did various other trains as well, like the smaller local trains. Like when I was staying in Paris, I did some kind of day trips from Paris around. Likewise in Amsterdam, I did some day trips. So the smaller trains, they were quite, I suppose, the old-fashioned trains, where you'd have the diesel locomotive in front and perhaps a diesel locomotive in back, which would drive the electronic motors under each carriage, which is quite smooth. The trains, what I experienced across Western Europe, were quite comfortable. You know, when the railroads first came along in Ireland 100, 200 years ago, whenever it was, I imagine we had the trains very much like perhaps what they're like throughout much of Russia and Eastern Europe. when I was travelling there in Eastern Europe, I suppose it made me think of what we had perhaps here years and years back. The trains there, instead of having electric-driven individual carriages, they have one like mom of a train locomotive in front that would literally physically pull every other carriage. So basically the first one moves and chug, each one of them turns pulled along. And when you're braking then, you can feel them all kind of going bang, 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 bang into one another. So the trains we have in Ireland and the trains I saw in Europe are a lot more smooth, which was great. Like, you just get in and fall asleep. There was no real discomfort or anything, so it was a great experience. I was staying in youth hostels all the time, so you meet great characters. It's amazing characters you meet, because usually there's so many Kiwis, so many Australians. It almost seems like a culture of travelling there. So it's great to meet people and just compare stories. When I was going from Paris to Belgium, I remember stopping off in Luxembourg City. It was like a 20-minute stop for some reason. The train was just standing on the platform before a continuous journey. And I knew I had 20 minutes. So I said to myself, look, I haven't planned to stay in Luxembourg, but I have to be able to say that I saw, I was there. I was in the country. I saw the city. So I remember just grabbing my bag, running off the train as fast as I could, running out of the station, running into the big plaza, standing there for literally 10 seconds, looking around. And I said, right, I was here. I can say I was here. And just literally running full speed back into the train. I suppose I can say I was there. Went to Belgium, went to Bruges. Beautiful, beautiful place. People are friendly as well. I suppose it's quite different as well from Ireland. There's no real place like Ireland. The train system was excellent, the way it was organised from the point of view in training, because you have your timetable. As such, it allows you to take, to a certain extent, any train you want. Went on to Amsterdam. My perception, I suppose, before I went, I suppose it was a bit naive, but I always had a picture in my mind as Amsterdam as this really dark, kind of dodgy city, really kind of like, you know, a sinister place. But I got there 10 o'clock at night. And my research had taught me that I needed to get off the train station at point A and get to my youth hostel at point B. But I didn't realize that I had to kind of walk through an area which I would have perceived to be a very dodgy area, and got to my youth hostel easy enough. But I discovered it was an incredibly beautiful city. Like, it's quite safe. It's quite a good city to travel in. I suppose Amsterdam has the name for certain things, but the people there were amazing, just to be able to meet the different cultures there. I suppose, like anywhere you travel, I suppose you have to be wise. It's up to yourself to a certain extent what you want to see, what you want to investigate. Some people go for museums. I wasn't too much into that. I wanted to experience things. I just wanted to be able to see the culture. Like, they have an amazing kind of a flea market area, kind of floral market. I wanted to see the people, see the trading, and just be able to walk through the markets and experience how people trade, how people buy. You walk into Oxford Street in London, of course, you'd never haggle in Harrods, but you go to somewhere like in certain countries, in the open markets, people haggle, people barter. So I suppose it's something I love to experience. And one thing that blew me away about Amsterdam's number of bikes. I remember walking down, and I didn't realize it, but I'd strayed onto the footpath. Next thing, I hear a cyclist bell behind me, and I discovered it's highly socially unacceptable to walk on bicycle tracks in Europe, especially Amsterdam. But the amount of bicycles, I thought was great. I suppose Amsterdam is so flat as well. It's a great place for cycling. I had it planned to a certain extent in the different towns I stopped in, as I was staying in youth hostels. Some nights it didn't work out, so it was kind of like a last minute caper where you'd have to search hard to get a youth hostel. I suppose it's part of the adventure as well. If you're into adventure, I definitely suggest interrailing, because not everything, no matter how well you plan things, there's always managed to be a glitch. But I suppose for me, what I loved was the adventure, getting to a place, finding a youth hostel, perhaps finding a bed was no longer there, trying to find a new youth hostel before they shut their doors. I suppose you had to be cautious as well about where you stayed and where you travelled. But like anything else, a bit of common sense goes a long way. The key thing is to plan, to be able to understand where the train station is, where the key places you want to see, and the main youth hostels or even hotels if you want to stay there. But just trying to plan it out so you know that if the one you've booked falls through, you've always got an option B or C. You can see the nervous travellers from the experienced travellers. You know, the nervous travellers are kind of they'll have everything booked to a T, whereas the experienced travellers know that you have to allow a certain amount of chance to enjoy the adventure. It's interesting that the people I met in youth hostels as well, all the travelling. English obviously is the common language of the world, but especially in youth hostels, because you've so many Kiwis, Australians, Americans travelling. Talking to people who had done overnight trips, they were telling me about basically you get your own bunk. So you just, because of the smoothness of the train, they were saying, and I suppose that the continuous momentum of the train, you wouldn't really even feel, you just snooze quite easily. Because even though there's sound from a motion, it's going to a continuous sound. So they were saying it's quite easy to sleep. They get their ticket, might get on a train, let's say at 9 o'clock at night. And they were telling me that they'd wake up in the morning. They might be 600-700 kilometers away from their starting point, but they'd be near where they have to be. So it's a great way to travel. So you can sleep and travel at the same time. Went from Dublin, flew to London, went to Paris, through Luxembourg, Belgium, Netherlands. And that was kind of like my couple of days here, my couple of days there. So that was time to come back. So then I retraced my steps from Amsterdam back through Belgium, back to Paris. So my plan was to get into Paris, get the TGV from Paris to Waterloo, and get from Waterloo out to Heathrow. I had allowed myself so many hours to get from Paris to London on the TGV because it was a high-speed train. I think I only needed 2 or 3 hours. And then I allowed myself, I think it was an hour, to get from Waterloo to Heathrow. And then I think another 2 hours before my flight left. So I would be in Heathrow ideally an hour and a half, 2 hours to go before my flight. I left Paris on the TGV. And just before we hit the underground tunnel, still inside France, the train had stopped at a scheduled stop at a station for some reason. But when it stopped, there was a problem with the pneumatics, or a problem with the doors in the train, and the doors wouldn't close. So we're sitting on the platform for ages and ages and ages, and we're there for more than an hour. I got up and I spoke to one of the train stewards, and I explained my problem that I had to be in Waterloo, had to be in Heathrow for a certain time. And he said, well, we have a problem with the doors. We don't know when we can rectify this, but I'll put you on another train. So I thought, great. Another train, I'll be in London 2 hours or however long it takes the TGV to get there. So I got on the other train, happy I'd sat down. And I looked out the window and I thought, are we not going a bit slow? And I looked around and suddenly I realised this wasn't a TGV. This was a bog standard train that does whatever, 60 miles an hour. Got to London and I got to Waterloo, got to Heathrow and ran all the way, Terminal 3, got to Terminal 3, realised I was in the wrong terminal. Got to the desk anyway, and just as I got there, I was looking at my watch, the plane had just left. So I hadn't ate all day, I was exhausted, tired. And I was just, I suppose, after lugging a backpack around, I looked like, I imagined I was in a fairly bad state. Explained my case to the girl. And like, God, it's amazing because I says, is there any chance of another flight? And I hadn't a penny on me to pay for another flight. So I says, look, I must still find out what it is and try to work something out. If I have to, I'll sit down with my cap for a few hours. But I thought to myself, I'll get home anyway. So she typed in my details. She said, yeah, there's another flight in 2 hours time. That won't bring you to Dublin, but it'll bring you to Cork. So I says, great. How much is that? And she says, no, it's free. There's a spare seat there. So thank God for that. Blown away. Like, because, you know, if I'd flown for another airline, which I won't mention, I'm sure now it would have been a few hundred euros. That was my experience of Interrail. It was amazing. It just blew me away. The people you meet, the experiences. It was a pity I didn't do it for like a month or 2 months. I didn't have it 2 months. But you know what I mean? Just to be able to travel. I love just being able to wake up in the morning and just say, where will I go in the world today? What will I do today? You know, one morning waking up in Paris, eating croissants and fresh French bread. And then think to myself, well, tomorrow morning I'll be waking up in Amsterdam or wherever it is, you know, doing something in agriculture. So it was great. I caught a train, I met a dame.
She was a hamster, yeah, a real gone dame. I suppose my first memory of the West Cork Railway was boarding the 12:15 train for Bantry at Albert Quay Station with my mother and my brother. I was probably around 4 at the time. Now, the station was located roughly where the Elysian Tower now stands. But sadly, very little evidence of the station remains today, except for the building on Albert Quay, which was once the head office for the Cork Bandon and South Coast Railway. Our train was an almost brand new 3-car diesel unit, painted green and looking rather resplendent in the early afternoon sun. We quickly boarded our carriage and had no problem in finding seats, as most of the carriages were usually only half full. We were heading off to visit our grandmother, not in Bantry, but to a place called Doris Road, which was the last stop before Bantry itself. There was, of course, great excitement at the anticipation of the journey ahead. This journey would be typical of many more trips west to see our Nana. And then at 12:15 sharp, and with the toot of the horn and a blow of the whistle, we were off at last. Slowly, we made our way out of the station, gathering speed as we went. The wheel flanges made a kind of a screeching sound as they negotiated the maze of tracks ahead, which brought us out under the signal cabin and then under the bridge at Rocksavage, then through the cutting, which would later and conveniently become a conduit for the South Link Road. Then on past Ballyfihane Junction, where you could still see the track of the old Macroom Railway to the right, but that line closed in 1953. On then to the Black Ash, an area now largely occupied by the Kinsale Road roundabout. Some say it got its name from when the firemen on the steam engines would rake out the ashes from the firebox somewhere around here. And then it was up the steep climb to Waterfall, which was the first station out of Cork. On the way, you could see the expanding suburbs of Paula Duff, Toker and Bishopstown below you to the right, and the fine vista of Cork City in the distance. Next was the first highlight of our journey, the Chetwynd Viaduct. This great feat of engineering was built to bridge the very wide span over the Bandon Road. Its huge pillars and ironwork remain to this day and is a fitting testimony to the men and the engineers who built our railways. Built at a time, one must remember, when, compared with today, engineering methods were still quite primitive. Now, even if your eyes were closed, you would always know when you were on the viaduct, because that familiar clickety-clack from the rails would suddenly change to a quieter rumbling sound. In those days, before the introduction of continuous welded track, the rails were connected together by a set of fish plates. Now, don't ask me why they were called fish plates. They were the farthest thing from a fish I ever saw. As the wheels crossed the little gap between the rails, it created this rhythmic, almost mesmerizing sound. Some considered it quite comforting
and had been known to send many a tired passenger off to sleep. Looking down from this lofty height was always both exciting and scary. You were looking down on the tops of the trees, and the few cars that you might see on the road below seemed to us more like dinky toys. After Waterfall, it was downhill to Ballinhasig. But before Ballinhasig would come the next highlight, the tunnel at Goggins Hill. There were two tunnels on the line, one at Goggins Hill and another at Kilpatrick just beyond Inishannon. Before we would enter the tunnel, the lights would come on in the carriage, and now, because of the blackness outside, all one could see out the window was one's own reflection. But very quickly, we were out into the sunshine again, and after a brief stop at Ballinhasig, we were on our way once more. From the next station at Crossbarry, a little further on, it was possible at one time to get a connection here for Kinsale, and that line closed in 1931. Now, less than a mile beyond Bandon Station was Clonakilty Junction, and from here another train would be waiting to take one to the town of Clonakilty itself. But on the way at Ballinasgarty, another branch line connected with the picturesque villages of Timileague and Corkmagcherry. Although still open, this line was now restricted to goods traffic and the odd excursion from Cork. After Dunmanway, the next junction was at Drimileague, where another line could take you to Skibbereen and on to Baltimore. There was even, at one time, a tramway from Skibbereen to Skull. The whole of West Cork was greatly served by this wonderful railway, and one can only imagine how much more prosperous this region might be if it had survived. Anyway, our journey is nearly over. Only one more stop at Ockaville before we reach our destination. The station at Durris Road was just a halt, really, and halt keepers Tim and Julie Harrington lived there with their family in a little red roof cottage just beyond the railway gates. The Harringtons were a very respected family in the area and also close neighbours and friends of my grandmother's. Directly across the tracks from the station house was a large goods shed with its own platform and siding. On the main platform itself stood a single building which housed the ticket office and waiting room. My grandmother's house was just a short distance away. After a breakfast of boiled eggs and delicious brown bread my grandmother had baked the day before, we would head out into the morning sun to begin our day of adventure. I liked nothing better than to walk along the railway, between trains of course, sometimes stepping from sleeper to sleeper, or just walking on the rails themselves to see how far I could go before I would lose my balance. Some of my fondest memories of those delightful days would be of particular sounds and smells. In the warm summer sun, I could get the sweet smell of summer grasses and honeysuckle, and sometimes, if the wind was right, I would get the odd whiff of turf smoke from my grandmother's chimney. Added to this would be the distinctive smell of creosote from the timber sleepers, a curious cocktail of aromas it may have been, but to me it was absolutely heavenly. Now, there was one particular sound which I will never forget. In a little forge down near the main road walked the local blacksmith, whose name was John O'Neill, and the sound of his hammer beating on the anvil could be heard ringing through the valley all day long. It could almost be likened to a bell calling the people to prayer. Then, on a beautiful warm July day in 1962, I was to witness the beginning of the end of the West Cork Railway, a day I'll never forget. I was playing in the high field beyond my grandmother's house when off to the west I saw a steam engine with a rake of flat wagons coupled behind. As the train was about a half a mile away, I couldn't make out at first what was happening. And then I noticed a man working a strange-looking contraption on the embankment below. My heart sank within me as I suddenly realised what was happening. They were lifting the rails. Curiosity got the better of me, and so I ran down the hill and climbed up onto the embankment and approached the man busy at work. He explained to me that he was going ahead of the train to loosen the bolts that tied the rails to the sleepers, and as we spoke, it became obvious that he was not at all happy with what he was doing. He sounded more like a reluctant executioner than a railway man, and I'm sure the other men back of the train felt the same. In front of the train was a railway, behind the train only ballast, with regular dents where the sleepers once lay. A vital artery which in future years could have brought prosperity and regeneration to West Cork was being ripped out.
Hans Balkin up next for Lofting the Viaduct. And this is the German's first attempt at what's become known as the Everest of road bowling. He's been bowling 15 years, since the age of 8, so he's not a newcomer. Hans preparing to take his run now, an impressive figure, 6.5 foot tall, with a fair stride and breathtaking technique. The 28-ounce bowl he'll be lofting today is, of course, lighter than he's used to. Preliminary figures for the crowd today stands at around 10,000, and the atmosphere is electric. The German is focused and determined as always as he faces the ramp ahead of him. The ramp, of course, a standard feature of German road bowling. The ramp doesn't really get used here in Ireland. And up he goes, a hush falling on the crowd. What a leap. He's certainly used the ramp to his best advantage. Up it goes. We've never had a successful loft. It's been claimed but never confirmed. The little iron ball looks like... And it's over! Absolutely amazing. Clearing the top of the viaduct by what looked like at least 10 feet. The crowd is roaring, and why not? It's a great day for road bowling. Ladies and gentlemen, Everest has been conquered.
So, what did you think of all that?
Do you think you could throw a ball over the viaduct?
I can certainly say, without doubt, that no, I couldn't. It's time for that walk. Do you remember Kieran that we spoke to before? He gives tours of one of the old abandoned lines, and I think the next one's starting in a minute. Ready?
Yeah, which line is it?
It's the one we heard about earlier, the Blackrock line.
The one that went all the way to Passage. We don't have to walk the whole way, do we?
I'm pretty sure we won't. We'll find out, though. Come on, if we hurry, we'll make it.
I've developed 10 walking tours, and I find them a very useful way to get people out walking in their area and getting an interest in their local history. So in terms of the old Cork, Black Rock and Passage railway line, we generally meet actually on the marina, and I give them a sense of the story of the marina walk and the boating clubs and the development of the area before even the marina was actually constructed, that the marina was a place called the Navigation Wall and it was a dock in the city. And then I start on what's now an amenity walk, but on the site of the old railway line, and we walk down and we pass through an old railway cutting and underneath kind of two bridges that were constructed.
So here we are on the Blackrock Passage railway line, long defunct. This first bridge actually is beautiful, isn't it? It's a pointed arch. It's kind of unusual. It's 1848, it says on it.
It's a beautiful custom.
This bridge here, just after it, it's got a twist on it. It's very strange. Great feat of engineering. Unfortunately, it's got this horrible pipe going through it underneath. But anyway, the twist in this arch is just incredible, the way it all comes together.
Yeah.
We're just coming up now to the platform in Black Rock and the station house there. A lovely little red brick thing with some dressed stone underneath where I presume the signal boxes were back in the day.
One of the bridges was constructed to give access into the Dean family lands in Dundanion. Another actually gave access that the Black Rock Road could actually run over the railway line as well. And some of the conditions for the workers, it was kind of fairly hard, and wages were actually low. To create a cutting through limestone, you had to use kind of gunpowder and kind of the dangers of that.
So this is an unused one now. There's nobody using it except the midges. Still, the workmanship's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's actually trees growing on top.
There's ivy.
And then further on then, like, we walk underneath another bridge called Ballinasheen Bridge, which was another kind of railway bridge actually constructed. It used to give access kind of over Skehard Road. They've widened Skehard Road over the years, so now Ballinasheen Bridge it's defunct as a road bridge, but it's actually still there. Further on, near the site of the old Besborough estate, the Pike family had their own kind of personal little railway kind of terminus.
Oh yeah, see this bridge up here?
Yeah.
See,
yeah.
It's actually one of the really beautiful old bridges. Some of the workmanship in it is amazing. Yeah, that's the old rail bridge.
Yeah, that'd be so hard to build because it's like going like that.
Yeah.
Going all in and out.
But as well, it looks like there's two different pieces of stone, like these really bumpy bits. And then inside it looks like really
that's
like
flat. That's because it's flattened.
Yeah, they only just did the one sides and left them kind of rough. And these ones at the top of the arch here,
yeah,
they smoothed them off as well because they need to be smooth to sit in, I suppose. Mm-hmm. This is actually it's a bigger tunnel than the going under the other bridge, isn't it?
Yeah.
Workmanship not so good on this.
Yeah.
Ah, cast concrete. Mm. Quick, efficient. And people need somewhere to do their graffiti as well.
Yeah. It's so dark.
It is pretty dark here, isn't it?
Yeah.
Through into the light. Wow, the sun came out as well. Look at that, it's beautiful. It's really peaceful.
Yeah.
You see the embankments going up?
Yeah. Wow. They kind of look like rock over rock or hill over hill, if you look.
Well, they do there, yeah, because it's all overgrown now.
Yeah.
So it's great to have such a straight road to walk on, isn't it? It's very flat. Because, do you know why?
Because
the
tracks.
So it wouldn't go blah, blah, blah. Like nowadays, roads with the lots of little bump, like potholes.
Potholes. Like.
That's right. The track here used to be 3 foot wide. It was a narrow gauge.
The beautiful trees. Beautiful. With the creating the shade. There's little cricket flowers too.
And the primroses. Lots of runners, isn't there? Yeah. Cyclists.
Because it's really long and you can just cycle all the way towards the step.
Oh, look, we're coming over to an old bridge.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, broken.
No, it's not broken. It's just the piece that went on top is gone. So people wouldn't be walking across it, I'd say.
Yeah.
Watch the bikes. So there you go. If we go any further, we'll be in Rochestown. So what do you think of that? Isn't that nice?
Yeah.
That was a lovely walk.
Beautiful.
So in the space of, I suppose, an hour and a half, I outline kind of the early origins of this kind of railway line. And then we walk back in from Besborough again. So that's what I'm trying to do, is trying to just draw a focus on the sense of place and the sense of nostalgia and memory that's actually connected with such heritage.
Okay, you can rest your legs for a while. We're off for our last trip to the model railway village in Clonakilty.
What do they do there?
Well, like in their name, it's a model of four towns 50 or 60 years ago and the railway that connected them. So you'll be able to see exactly what we've been talking about over the past 3 weeks.
Hello, my name's Kim McNamara. I'm the manager of the West Cork Model Railway Village in Clonakilty.
It's a visual history of West Cork on how things used to work. Before electrification, the Rural Electrification happened, the railway closed in 61, so it's all capturing the time before that, 40s, 50s. And then we've enhanced it over the years with the choo-choo train ride, the children's playroom, the children's play area. We have the cafe and gift shops. We've all added over the last 20 years, increasing the places of interest for people to come in.
Family orientated, isn't it? And also having the playroom, if it was raining, and then even the fact the train is covered over, so you're covered for all weathers as well.
Yeah.
And the scenery is just
so
incredible.
Scenic.
Could you tell me the noise trains make?
Tissue.
I expected a museum.
Yeah.
I just came along.
You've got a bit of history here, definitely, but it's all sort of the kids love it.
This is honestly incredible.
Yeah.
I love the little. I was like a kid.
We came down from Dublin for a few days. We're staying in Blarney, and we're looking to do things with the family, not too far from Blarney. So.
I like the idea of Clonakilty, and I wanted to come down to see what was available in the area, and they recommended it.
We'd seen in the book, the Western Southwest Adventure, the model train railway, and the baby's two. She loves trains. Dylan used to love Thomas the Tank Engine and all that stuff.
When he was a child.
So we decided we'd come here.
Yeah, no, I liked the idea. I mean, I know you said about boys liking their trains, but they don't grow up. I mean, there was older men coming in today that were excited about looking at the model railways. And, you know, it's for all ages, and the kids like going on the actual train. It's just nice to see the little details of the models that are made up and the small figures and the amount of work that's gone into restoring it. And obviously you can see it's an act of love.
We have four towns, Clonakilty, Kinsale, Bandon and Dunmanway. And each town is a representative of how those towns used to look in the 40s and 50s with accurate architecture. Architectural buildings. They're made of fiberglass and resin. Everything is handmade here. The ponds we have represent the rivers and the bays that they're resting on as well. But the kids love it, right? From the tiny tots up to about 10, 12 year olds. They love to be able to see things at eye level. They love to follow the trains around. They'll spend the afternoon just walking around the towns following the trains. Mums and dads are happy when the kids are happy. The whole concept has grown over the years. It was more or less a historical copy, but now it's kind of more entertaining, more encompassing, with children's sort of point of view taken care of, as well as the train buff and the historical buff. Everyone's kind of catered for.
Well, I'm just looking at the old trains over as well, the old trains that I used to travel as well, and I remember them as well, going to Dublin, even in the old trains, really impressed me. The models of the old town of Clonakilty as well here. as well. It's fabulous to see it, like, and the church and the cathedral and everything here, fabulous. And you know, everything there just is very good, really. You know, I remember the old trains, like everyone just packing. You know, you hang out the windows, really. You know, in the old trains, and you know, they got away. No, I know you wouldn't get away, but no, but it was great, and I thought it was great excitement as well. You know,
the kids are more interested in the trains, but then the adults are more interested, in, and they recognise a lot of places as well. Because it's all how it was in the 1940s, and a lot of things nowadays have changed, especially around Clonakilty. Mm. And people are like, oh, there, I used to live there as a little girl, and I used to do this. And
can I ask you some questions about trains, what? Please? What do you think about trains?
Cool.
Would you be able to make some train noises for me?
Choo choo!
Would you be able to make some train noises for me?
Choo choo!
Oh, and you?
Choo choo!
What's your most favourite part about trains?
When they often go really fast.
The majority of our visitors are Irish, and they'd be coming down to Clonakilty and West Cork in general for a visit, 2 or 3 days, weeks, holidays. You have the lovely beaches and that as well. They'll expect quaintness. They'll expect a little bit of living history, because we're showing things how they were, and it's a great reference point for grandparents to tell their children how things were when they were children. We've taken people from unemployment to employ them locally. We're giving their pride in themselves back. They have great pride in the model village. And also, when people come in, I suppose it's entertaining for them, it's informative, and it's a bit of fun.
There's no real downside to it. I've always worked with railway, model railway stuff, so this is just like living in heaven, really. Until we retired, we had a model shop in England. So I've always been involved with selling trains and making trains. Well, we're trying to run steam, basically, but there are a few diesels, purely because of the availability of commercial products. We got two new ones on the Clonakilty, which actually make proper train sound, so the kids like that.
I have two small boys, one is 2 and the other is 3. They're here beside me and ready to bolt any minute. But they would be big into all those kind of Thomas the Tank Engine and all that kind of stuff, so this would be a big draw for them. Mm-hmm. I can't believe the artistry in it now that I'm here. That from purely from the perspective of an adult, I suppose, the artistry and the work that's gone into it is really remarkable. It's excellent. I don't get to travel much by train now, other than the fact that it's just, so I find it really relaxing to sit on a train and be brought somewhere and, you know, not have to concentrate or be watching the road or anything like that. My sister is living not too far from here, so to tie in a visit to her and to keep the boys occupied for a little while was the reason for coming first day.
When a visitor comes through the gate, they're onto a train platform. They see the trains waiting at the station, and they see a couple waiting to go on the train. They get the ticket from the ticket office and go through the waiting room. And in the waiting room, we have little people waiting there to go board the train. We have a little train set that they can sort of play with as well or look at. And they step back into the model village and they walk around and see all the models in the towns. Well, it is a moment in time. If you think, going back to, say, your grandparents' time when they were children, rural electrification hadn't happened, the railways were still running, there weren't any big supermarkets, no one had a car except the local doctor and local priest. Say on Dunmanway here now, we have the butter exchange, which the local housewives, farmers' wives will come in with their butter they've made during the week. They'd sell it at the butter exchange and go and do their shopping in the market. Friday was fish day, everyone come in town, buy their fish on Friday, and it was a way for everyone to socialise as well. So you're showing that, you're showing a busy day, everyone coming into town, and how important the trains were in the area. There was a petition signed in West Cork, and it was one of the only places that did object to the closure of the railway. And the principle was, we needed it for the transportation of people, number one, and then they were using it for transportation of cereals like sugar beet up to the mallow factory. They were using it to transport cattle to and from the markets, and all goods as well. Sorry. So people, if they wanted to go to Dublin, so the train system all around the country was quite good.
This place is brilliant. Why do you love it?
Because of the trains.
Do you like trains?
Yes. The multicoloured one.
Well, the boys now, just the engines, they love it. They absolutely love it. I was surprised. I didn't think it would be as good now. It's brilliant. Mm-hmm. Absolutely brilliant. The engines going round and that there, but yeah, I think it's brilliant. Though. It's very well done, you know, of good good interpretation of the railways and that. You know, it's very good.
To see the scale of it and things, that's what brought me here anyway, I suppose. As I came with my nephews, it's very relaxing here anyway. I think it's very relaxing.
I just thought it was a terrific idea having a model railway village so close. And my grandson, he's old enough now, he's 3, so that's why we came here. So we thought it was a great afternoon, and the idea of taking the little train into the village is lovely too. So like, you've got the place names and of different places like Kinsale and Bandon and different places around. So like, it's giving you an idea of what you could go look at later, you know. But it's just the detail of everything. So it's lovely. My father was a brakeman on the Illinois Central for a few years after World War II. So yeah, we always had a little model railway in the basement of the house.
Why bother with your social history? It's what you come from. It's what tells you how you got to where you are today. It gives you information about how things were. You can't not see how things happened in the past. You have to see how things worked in the past. Whether for better or for worse, Ireland is where it is now, where everyone nearly has a car and, you know, everyone's rushing. That pace of life is, when you come in here, it's a slower pace of life. And it's showing that. And the kids coming around and taking their time, and the parents reading the storyboards and getting that bit of social history. I didn't know that this happened here. You know, these towns, they've changed. So if you tell someone, oh, there was a butter exchange or there was a market on this day, you know, they never knew that. So it's given them a bit of social history. We tie in with other businesses. We're promoting West Cork as a place for people to come. And the model village is used by all the tourist orientated businesses in town to say, have you been down here? This is something you can do on a good day or a bad day. It doesn't matter. And it just ties in with all the tourism of West Cork. We've been listed on the Wild Atlantic Way as a place of interest to come as well, which is great.
Could you make the sound of a train for me?
Roar! Mom, you'll never guess where we were today. Come on, peace train.
Yes, it's the peace train. For making this part of the documentary possible, I would like to thank Kieran McCarthy, Tom Ryan, Raymond Good, Dennis Brennan, Use It, Hans Balkan and Balkumina Heron, Kim McNamara and the staff of the Clonakilty Model Railway Village, and Arthur Shortall. Thanks for joining us over the past 3 weeks. I hope you've enjoyed our documentary, Making Tracks, Railroads and the Irish.
This programme was funded by the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland with the television licence fee.